In this video, I want to introduce some peripheral neurological disorders. Peripheral, meaning they're affecting the peripheral nervous system. Neurological disorders. And when we're talking about neurological disorders affecting the peripheral nervous system, we're mostly talking about things that affect the nerves. But we also usually throw in the diffuse disorders of skeletal muscle. And you hear, sometimes we refer to that as neuromuscular disorders instead, to be a little bit more accurate that we're talking about both nerves and skeletal muscle. And there are many disorders that can cause either focal or diffuse dysfunction up the peripheral nervous system or skeletal muscle. Now, with abnormalities of skeletal muscle, we may see the motor abnormality of weakness. And with abnormalities of nerves, we may also see motor abnormalities, including weakness. But with abnormalities of nerves, we may also see sensory abnormalities and or autonomic abnormalities. Autonomic. Because nerves contained bundles of axons carrying motor information, sensory information, or autonomic information between the central nervous system and the periphery. The symptom of pain, in particular, is a common sensory abnormality that can occur with the peripheral neurological disorders. So if somatosensory axons, those carrying sensory information from the body, including the sense of pain, that's a common sensory abnormality that may occur with lesions of somatosensory axons in nerves. Now, if we start thinking about the peripheral neurological disorders, first in terms of the ones that cause focal lesions or focal areas of abnormalities in the peripheral nervous system, these usually cause motor or somatosensory abnormalities of one arm or one leg. Certain parts of certain nerves are most often affected, usually by the mechanical pathology of compression by surrounding structures, such as parts of the wrist or parts of the spine. Although we can also sometimes see compression from external objects at areas where nerves are vulnerable, like at the funny bone of the elbow. Focal dysfunction of one nerve out in the periphery is called a mononeuropathy. Mono for one, neuropathy for dysfunction of a nerve. Mononeuropathy. Whereas we have a different name for focal dysfunction of one spinal nerve close to where they're attached to the spinal cord. We call that radiculopathy. Radiculopathy. And both mononeuropathy, where a single nerve has a focal abnormality out in the periphery, and radiculopathy, where a single spinal nerve has an abnormality. These are both very common neurological syndromes. Now, in addition to focal lesions occurring from peripheral neurological disorders, we can also have diffuse lesions. Let me just write that over here. Diffuse lesions or diffuse abnormalities of the peripheral nervous system. Diffuse dysfunction of the nerves, kind of all of the nerves being sick, we call polyneuropathy. Poly for many, and neuropathy for an abnormality of the nerves. Polyneuropathy. And with polyneuropathy, we usually have widespread motor, sensory, and autonomic abnormalities on both sides of the body. And most types of polyneuropathy have an additional pattern to them where the longest nerves are often the most affected, where they're farthest away from the central nervous system. So for polyneuropathy, the most common syndrome we see are motor, sensory, or autonomic abnormalities starting in the toes. And then as things get more severe, it actually kind of crawls its way up the legs. And then when it gets to about the knees, the hands often start to get involved as well. And so all the nerves are affected by these processes, but the longest nerves in particular, with many of them, are often affected the worst and the earliest. And we get a very different pattern with diffuse dysfunction of skeletal muscle, which we call myopathy. This word myo refers to muscle. So a myopathy is diffuse dysfunction of skeletal muscle. And when skeletal muscle is affected, we don't see autonomic or sensory abnormalities, but we do see the motor abnormality of weakness, because if skeletal muscle is not functioning properly, you don't have full strength. And most types of myopathy give us a very different pattern than the polyneuropathy pattern. Let me just erase all of this, because it looks very different with most myopathies. Instead of seeing abnormalities farthest away from the central nervous system, what we often see is weakness around the shoulders on both sides and the hips on both sides, and often kind of the big muscle groups of the going into the legs and the arms close to the shoulders and the hips as well. As a myopathy becomes more severe, it may start to involve all the muscle groups, including farther away down the legs and the arms and the torso and the head and neck. But early on, many types of myopathy give us this particular kind of pattern that we don't see with lots of other neurological disorders. Many types of pathology commonly cause polyneuropathy or myopathy, including certain genetic disorders, idiopathic disorders, autoimmune disorders, metabolic disorders, nutritional, and toxic disorders. So there's a lot of different disorders that can cause these patterns, these syndromes, in the bigger category of peripheral neurological disorders.